So start explaining. Subhadashni.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, say about the band broadening theories.
Band broadening theories is classified into plate theory and rate theory. Plate theory it comes under high equivalent to theoretical HETP. They are performed in stationary phase.
Height equivalent to theoretical plane.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Your voice was breaking, no? That's why I repeated.
Plate height depends on particle size of adsorbent. And then rate theory, it is determined by Van Diemter equation.
Say about Van Diemter equation. Can you represent the formula?
The A, B and C, the eddy diffusion and longitudinal diffusion and resistance of mass transfer in mobile phase and stationary phase. Sum of these three.
Okay, good. Subhadashni. Next, anybody else? Can anybody explain about band broadening theories and resolution? Stephen? Stephen, can you explain? Yeah, proceed.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Say about band broadening theories and resolution. Second, can you explain?
No.
Voice is not audible only. You come out from other noises and start explaining. Joy John.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, say about band broadening theories
and resolution. There are two types of broad bandering theory, ma'am. That are plate theory and rate theory. The plate model supposes that the orthographic columns contain a large number of separate layers. That's are called theoretical plates, ma'am. In rate theory, it is based on the Van Diemter equation. Then about resolution, there is an equation that R is equal to 2 into VRB minus VRA divided by WA plus WB.
Okay. Can you say about the difference between resolution and separation factor?
Yes, ma'am.
resolution and separation, the difference between these two. Anybody else talking about the difference between separation factor and resolution? Anybody else can explain about the difference between separation factor and resolution under partition theories? Deepan? Deepan, can you explain? Whoever is willing to say about the difference, you can unmute your mic and say. Baby Kartika. Yeah.
Don't know.
No. Okay. So nobody listened the class, right? Then the last class I have said the difference between separation factor and resolution.
Ma'am, in resolution factor, it does not depend on width, peak width.
Yeah. Where resolution is saying about a peak width also. That's why we consider resolution when comparing with separation factor. Okay. And note down the optimum value for separation factor and resolution to get best resolution and best separation. Okay, we'll proceed with the column chromatography, the first type of column chromatography, that is column adsorption chromatography. Thank you all for your answers. Kindly go through the class videos after class also, if you have not listened properly. Okay, so let's move on to column adsorption chromatography. Column adsorption chromatography is nothing but column chromatography itself. We will be calling this as column chromatography itself. Hope you know the application of column chromatography, which is applicable for separation and isolation. Okay, it is going to, chromatography means it is applicable for separation, but in column chromatography, mainly column adsorption chromatography, will be going for purification also, like PTLC, preparative TLC. Here also it is applicable for isolation. That means high purification technique it is. We can isolate a compound with a highly sensitive manner comparing with preparative TLC. About definition and history, we have discussed in the last class itself. So I'll move on to the column chromatographic parameters. So under column adsorption chromatography, you can observe the picture of column adsorption, how separation and isolation taking place. First, the band is getting separated, the sample is getting separated, and it is isolated out as a fraction. Individual components are getting isolated from the column as fractions. Okay, so they are called as elutate molecules. This is the column chromatographic procedure, and which is applicable for purification. So the single compound is recovered out from the mixture. Okay, that is the main application, separation and isolation. Okay, isolation here represents purification. We are getting single component as purified one. Okay, so from the mixture, so it is called purification or isolation technique. How it is purified or isolated? By means of separation. So only it is classified under chromatography. Chromatography is applicable for separation by means of the principal adsorption, column adsorption. It is called as column adsorption chromatography. Let's move on to its parameters, chromatographic parameters, column chromatographic parameters. It comprises of principal, column, stationary phase, column packing methods, mobile phase selection, then sample preparation and application, recovery or elution of compounds, deduction applications. These are all the parameters we are going to discuss Okay, principle behind column chromatography, then column, what material of column is used, what type of column is used for separation and aeration, like this column, what type of column is preferred, and what is stationary phase where separation is taking place as a band. So what stationary phase inside column we are going to prefer, then column packing, how the stationary phase is packed inside the column, then mobile phase, what solvent is used for separation or elution of the sample from the column, then sample preparation and application, how your sample is loaded over the column and what way, then recovery and elution of compounds, here how the compound is eluted or recovered from the column after separation. And then deduction, the eluted fractions, are going to be deducted. Here you can observe white color, blue color and orange color compounds. So each compound will be of different category that is going to be characterized later. Once it is purified, it will be characterized. So what are the deduction methods available to characterize the isolated compound? And then what are the different applications of column chromatography? So these are all the things we are going to discuss. First is principle of separation, then column, what type of column, then what is stationary phase, then how column is packed, then mobile phase, how it is, what type of mobile phase is used to isolate or purify your sample in the stationary phase, then what sample, how sample is prepared and applied over the column for separation and isolation, then what is the elution and how the compounds are eluted or recovered from the column, then deduction, what are the deduction procedures for the eluted compounds, then applications. Okay, these are all the key notes we are going to discuss. First about principle is adsorption. How adsorption takes place means by means of the process called here adsorption. After loading your sample, adsorption takes place in the column by means of the procedure called hydrogen bonding. Okay, chemical reaction called hydrogen bonding and physical reaction called van der Waals force. Okay, due to van der Waals force, a physical force, compound will be separated or adsorbed onto the stationary phase. Okay, it is based on the hydrogen bonding, that means reversible hydrogen bonding, reversible and irreversible will be there, right? Reversible hydrogen bonding occurs between your sample and stationary phase so that it is getting adsorbed onto the surface. We have seen many adsorption theories also. It is also followed where physical force of adsorption is due to van der Waals adsorption. Okay, van der Waals adsorption you should have heard. So that is the physical process behind adsorption, where chemical process behind adsorption is hydrogen bonding formation, reversible hydrogen bonding. So this means no chemical change occurs with the sample. We can recover your sample with highly purified nature. So what is the basic mechanism behind adsorption? Hydrogen bonding as chemical reaction and van der Waals forces physical process or physical reaction. Okay, thereby your compound is getting adsorbed. Based on its adsorbing capacity, either it will be getting adsorbed more in stationary phase or it will be distributed in mobile phase more, so that it will be getting isolated out as a single compound from mixture. So your no compound will be having same physical force or same chemical nature or same hydrogen bonding nature or adsorbing nature, so that each component will be separated based on the different adsorption capacity. It will be eluted individually from the column. That is the concept. So principle is adsorption takes place. Adsorption is nothing but surface phenomenon. This occurs due to van der Waals force and hydrogen bonding, reversible hydrogen bonding. And once the maximum adsorption it has reached your compound, then it will be getting isolated from the column. That is the concept. Okay, once it is getting equilibrium or maximum adsorption towards the stationary phase and mobile phase, if it is getting partition between two, equilibrium between two phases, it will be getting separated from the mixture and will be the from the column. By adding more amount of mobile phase, you can elute out the particular separated compound from the column. That is the concept. The principle followed here is adsorption. For isolation, adsorption principle is followed. For adsorption, So what type of column and what type of adsorbent we are going to choose, we'll see. Second, about column. First, about principle we have discussed, that is adsorption. Next, about column. Material used, either glass or plastic material is used. Okay, here you can observe the column, how it is. It is a glass column. Here, this is how your column chromatograph appears for isolation. Either it will be made with glass or plastic. Mostly we'll prefer glass only. Plastic somewhat it will be translucent. Glass will be transparent, so that we can see the color bands clearly. So that glass columns are preferred widely. Dimension of the columns based on the sample size. If it is less sample size, length you can prefer, less distance, less length of column can be preferred. That is of 10:1. 10:1. 10 represents length of column, 1 represents internal diameter of the column. Internal diameter, it should be 10:1 ratio for less number of compounds. For more number of compounds, it should be 100:1. Column length, 100 represents length, 1 represents internal diameter of the column. So this is how dimension of column is preferred based on sample size. Okay, so for more number of components we require, just imagine HETP, we require more number of theoretical plates in the column, separating more number of samples, so that length is high, and HETP plate theory depends on length of column, L divided by N, right? Length of column and number of theoretical plates. So based on HETP, we can decide what dimension of the column also. It is depending on number of sample, number of compounds in the sample going to be separated. If a mixture has two samples only, then length you can prefer 10:1. If you want to separate more than 10 samples, then you have to prefer 10 number of components in a mixture. In a single sample, if it has more than 10 compounds, then you can prefer 100:1 dimension. So what is the material of column is preferred? Glass, maximum glass or plastic can be used. Then glass advantages, transparent and it is compatible with all the samples. Plastic advantages, it is not breakable, where glass is breakable. Plastic is translucent to the color separation, so that we will be preferring glass only for most of the isolation. What is the dimension is preferred? How it is selected based on number of compounds in the mixture, what we are taking, our sample, what we are taking for isolation or purification, based on that dimension is decided. Okay, this is about selection of column for the isolation. So first we have seen principle adsorption. It is based on hydrogen bonding and physical force, van der Waals force. Okay, thereby the sample is getting adsorbed between stationary phase and mobile phase, stationary phase and mobile phase. When it is getting equilibrium, the interaction is getting equilibrium between two phases, stationary phase and mobile phase, the compound is getting separated from the mixture. And when it is isolated, when we add more amount of mobile phase, it will be flushed out from the column as a single fraction. That is how it is purified and recovered from the column. Then column selection is material and dimension we have seen. Material is glass or plastic, dimension based on sample size. Next we'll move on to the stationary phase. So what principle we are following? Adsorption. So for adsorption, achieving adsorption principle, what adsorbent must be used? Silica gel. Silica gel of column chromatography grade must be used. You have to see while using silica gel. It is not having, what is the difference between silica gel G and silica gel for column chromatography? We have discussed already under TLC, we are using silica gel G, right? What is silica gel G? It is adsorbent plus binder to form a thin layer. Okay, here we don't need layers, no need to get a layer in column chromatography. So only merely silica gel like crystals will be using. Okay, so that silica crystals meant for column chromatographic application is preferred with a mesh size of 60:120. This is ideal for all samples, 60:120. When you want to separate more number of compounds. If you want to reduce the silica gel particles for smaller particles, then you can choose 232 400 mesh size. When mesh size is increased, your sample size or what we can say particle size will be, silica gel particle size will be very minimum. When pore size is reduced, silica gel particle size will be high. Okay, it is inversely proportional. Particle size of silica gel is inversely proportional to mesh size, what is mentioned here. 60 to 120 represents big particle size of silica gel. 230 to 400 mesh size represents smaller particles. So we can separate more number of compounds when we use 230 to 400. If your mixture is having more number of compounds, then we can go with 230 to 400. If it is having less number of compounds, then we can go with 60 to 120 mesh columns. Silica gel, where 230 to 400 will be preferred for flash chromatography. For normal chromatography, 60 to 120 mesh size is preferred. Okay, for normal column separation and isolation, 60 to 120 is sufficient. For flash column chromatography, flash means by using pressure we'll be separating. For that case, we can go with smaller, very smaller particles. So that is achieved by passing the silica gel particles into the mesh of 230 to 400 size. Okay, this is how stationary phase for column chromatography is chosen. Okay, where TLC will be using silica gel G, that is meant for TLC application. So TLC grade silica gel is preferred for TLC purpose, thin layer chromatography, along with binder, where column chromatographic silica gel will not be having binder. It is a crystal, so that only it can flow inside the column to settle or to get packed for separation. Okay, these are crystals. What is the size? 60 to 120 or 230 to 400 mesh size. Okay, then let's move on to column packing. So till now, what are the, how many points we have discussed? Principle of separation, that is adsorption, then column is preferred, what type of column is preferred, and what type of adsorbent is preferred for column chromatography. Fourth is column packing. So once you choose column and stationary phase, you have to pack the stationary phase into the column. There are two methods, dry method and wet packing method. Here advantageous method is wet packing method. Let's see what is dry packing method. In dry packing, the column is selected. Okay, this is the column, either fritted column or non-fritted column. Mostly fritted column will be using, that is with stopcock. Okay, here it is shown with a non-fritted column. Fritted column like burette, just imagine burette is the column. Okay, we can take, we are consider burette as the column. First, that is filled with sand. This yellow color thing is sand, okay, to get a base. Then you are have to add silica into it. Whenever you add some reagent or adsorbent or mobile phase, you have to use funnel, okay, so that you can get uniform flow inside the column. So silica is transferred to column, then it is allowed to settle. Then we are adding mobile phase solvent. Okay, mobile phase solvent to the settled silica gel particles until it reaches some 3/4 distance. Then we have to close the column and allow to settle nicely. To get tight packing. So it is representing dry packing method, where in dry packing method, silica is as a crystal. It is in the beginning itself, it is added to added for packing, and then solvent is added. Okay, what is the disadvantage? I told wet packing method is advantageous one comparing with dry packing. What is the disadvantage of dry packing then? When we add solvent after adding your silica particles, when solvent is trying to saturate inside the silica gel particle, it creates vacuum. Okay, vacuum. Hence, this vacuum causes air bubble formation in it. Okay, air bubbles formation due to vacuum formation while getting saturated. Just imagine you are adding some water directly to the powder. It will not uniformly dissolve, get dissolved. Okay, until you stir or mix properly, it will not get dissolved. Like lumps you will be getting. Likewise, when you add solvent after adding silica to the column, it will create vacuum that creates air bubbles. Okay, so it stops uniform isolation of your sample, and this air bubble makes column cracking. Cracking means breaking of the column particles, so that uniform isolation or separation will not get through dry packing method. But this is also an option for packing method. Due to this disadvantage, we are moving to wet packing method. So how this wet packing method is done? First sand is filled to get a base. Okay, after keeping sand, we need to keep a cotton also, and then we have to add solvent. Okay, before add solvent to get base, usually we'll not be adding solvent in the beginning itself. We will use the solvent to make slurry, like in a beaker. Here how slurry is made: the slurry composed of your adsorbent and solvent. Slurry composed of adsorbent and solvent, and you have to stir by means of stirrer itself. Since it is a crystal, we can stir it easily and it will be forming slurry, pourable slurry. Okay, and you have to add by means of funnel, you have to pour the slurry inside the column. Now it is saturated, your adsorbent is saturated in the beginning itself before adding to the column itself, so it is completely saturated, so no air bubble formation occur now. Okay, that is why wet packing method is advantageous, and it is added to the column until it reaches 3/4, or according to our convenience, based on your sample composition, we can fix the distance. Mostly 3/4 of the column is filled with the slurry, and then it is allowed to pack. We have to tap the column outside with the rubber tubes. Okay, we can tap on the sides of the column with the rubber tube so that it will be settling equally. Okay, and we will be getting the nice packed columns after that. So once it is packed tightly, it is ready for isolation. Okay, these are the two methods for isolation: dry packing method and wet packing method. So now your column is ready with adsorbent packed, okay, for isolation. So what is the next step? So what are the two packing methods? Dry packing, wet packing. Which is advantageous? Wet packing. What is the disadvantage of dry packing? It forms air bubbles during saturation with the solvent. This air bubble formation leads column cracking. So it will stop your or restrict your uniform isolation of sample. So hence wet packing method is preferred. Okay, here we are making slurry of adsorbent before adding to the columns, so no air bubble formation occurs and uniform settling of column material, that is adsorbent, occurs here. Just a second, I put charger. So after packing, once the stationary phase is ready, now the next part is selection of mobile phase for isolation, movable phase for isolation. And this mobile phase has three roles here. One, it is first role is it is acting as a solvent. What solvent here we have mentioned for packing. Okay, so it is acting as solvent for packing and also for sample preparation. Okay, sample preparation, we are using mobile phase solvent as solvent. Okay, so it is acting as solvent. First role of mobile phase is solvent. Second role of mobile phase is developing agent. It is developing the different bands for separation, right? In the first slide we have seen separated bands. So it is used for separation. Since mobile phase is moving in the column continuously, your sample is getting separated into individual compounds from the mixture. So it is acting as developing reagent. First it acted as solvent for sample and solvent for adsorbent. For stationary phase and your sample, it is acting as solvent. Then next point, it is acting as developing agent or separating agent. Developing agent only, it is called as. That means it is used for separation. And third role of mobile phase is eluent or eluting agent. By means of continuous flow of mobile phase, your compound is getting eluted out from the column, that is recovered out from the column. So your mobile phase has three roles. First is solvent, then developing agent, then eluting agent. Okay, this is how your mobile phase plays in column. So what type of mobile phase is chosen for elution? Elution with successive increasing in polarity of solvents. We'll be selecting with increasing polarity of solvents, from non-polar to polar solvents. Already you have seen the list of non-polar to polar solvents in TLC. Refer those list, okay? And that can be applicable. Example, from we can select from petroleum ether. It is highly non-polar. Then we are coming to the next increased polarity of sample, that is chloroform, then ethyl acetate, then methanol, then water. It is highly polar. So we are increasing polarity gradually for isolation, and then it is added to the column as mobile phase. Okay, why we need to add non-polar solvents in the beginning means, mostly I mentioned in the first class itself, I think so, polar, your pharmaceutical substances or therapeutic substances are polar in nature. So that we have to get highly purified polar compounds only. But your mixture may be comprised of non-polar and polar compounds. When you require only polar compounds, this non-polar compounds will have interaction with the polar compound. If you are not eliminating non-polar from the mixture. So in view of eliminating non-polar compounds from the mixture, we are using non-polar solvents in the beginning for the elution. So all non-polar substances like fatty substances will be non-polar, means fatty or hydrocarbons will be eluted out from the column. Then polar solvents will be free of those non-polar compounds. When you add polar solvents like ethyl acetate, methanol, water, all your active components, therapeutic components will be eluted out from the column. That meaning only, we are selecting mobile phase from non-polar to polar manner. Solvents also selected. Okay, so example is from petroleum ether, chloroform, ethyl acetate, methanol and water can be chosen as gradually increased polarity of solvents as mobile phase. So what are the three roles of mobile phase in column chromatography? It is acting as solvent, then developing agent, then eluting agent. And how the mobile phase is chosen from non-polar to polar solvents for column chromatography. So how many points we have discussed till now? 5 points. First one, adsorption, then about selection of column, then selection of stationary phase, then column packing, now mobile phase. Now stationary phase and mobile phase is ready for isolation. Now what is this next step? Sample. What sample is to be isolated? Okay, so how the sample is prepared here? Preparation and application of sample over the column is mentioned. The sample, which is usually a mixture of components, is dissolved in minimum quantity of mobile phase. How it is prepared with the mobile phase? Already I said mobile phase is acting as solvent for sample. So it is prepared with mobile phase. How it is applied to the column? The entire sample is like drop by drop capillary. Usually in TLC, how we are placing sample by means of capillary, a drop of sample is placed. Here not like that. The entire sample, like in ml wise, milliliter wise, it is added to the column. Okay, at once it is added, and get a sample is allowed to get adsorbed. Individual samples can be sent. Hope you have recollect the point. Here you can see how the sample is loaded. Okay, load example and mobile face is added. Okay, and then at once we have added the sample. Once you add mobile face over there, it is prepared with mobile face only, same solvent we are using throughout the column, same solvent. Stationary face also prepared with mobile face, sample also have been prepared with mobile face, and it is loaded at once, and then we are adding mobile face at the top of the column. Then this mobile phase acting as developing agent now here, then it is separating all the mixtures, whatever mixture is present in the sample is getting separated into individual bands. Okay, this is about sample application and getting elution process. Next we'll see what is elution. Elution is, now you should have understood, it is recovery of sample. Elution of or isolating out your compound from the column is called as elution, or eluting out your sample, is a separated sample from the column is called as elution or recovery. We are recovering the sample. Where in TLC and PTLC we cannot recover when we add reagents, right? So here column chromatography, we can recover the samples as individual compounds. What are the two techniques of elution? Isocratic elution and gradient elution. There are two elution techniques available, isocratic and gradient elution. What is isocratic elution? When we use same solvent throughout the elution, then it is called isocratic elution. What is gradient elution? When we increase polarity gradually, I mentioned during mobile phase selection, polarity is increased gradually for successive separation or elution. That type of elution is called gradient elution. Gradient represents different elution technique. Iso represents same polarity solvent is used. So if you use only single solvent throughout the separation and isolation, then it is called isocratic elution. If you use like chloroform alone throughout the isolation, then it is called as isocratic elution. Or if you use water only, or if you use methanol only, like a single polarity if we use, then it is called isocratic. The same polar solvents, when we prefer, the technique of elution is called isocratic. Gradient means different polarity or different elution strength of solvents are preferred, then it is called as a gradient elution. This is about recovery or elution. Sorry, this slide I actually supposed to delete. Eluted, you should have seen in the beginning, the first slide itself, recovered samples are eluted and recovered in a fraction collector, right? So after collecting the sample, we need to detect what type of sample has been isolated out as a single compound. It is done by three methods. First one, preliminary screening, then chromatographic analysis, then spectroscopic analysis. What are the preliminary screening we'll be doing? Firstly, it is also comprising chromatography, that is TLC. Then we'll be checking some pH analysis, preliminary chemical test.
Mm-hmm.